Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. This video is part of the series about Fernand E. Saussure's essay, The Object of Study. This video will be all about Fernand E. Saussure's life and works, while the next video, which I'll be posting soon, will be about the summary of the essay, The Object of Study. So now we can talk about his life. He was born to a noble Calvinist family of Henry D. Saussure and Countess Louise D. Portalis in Geneva on November 26, 1857. He was the first of the nine children, and his family, the Saussures, were well known for their contribution in modern science and education. Henry, his father, sent his first two sons, Fernand and Horace, to the same school, and it was at this school that Fernand has got an initial understanding about the classical languages, which is German and English. And at the age of 12, he was brought back to École Martin, which is in Geneva, in 1870. And then he went to the Public College of Geneva in 1872. He then further went to the Gymnase of Geneva. And finally, he was admitted to the University of Geneva. And it was at this time that he started his formal study of linguistics under the guidance of Louis Morel, who is a researcher at the University of Leipzig. So as his guide was at the University of Leipzig, he decided to transfer to the Leipzig, University of Leipzig in 1876. And he was in company with several teachers such as Hermann Ostorff and Karl Brugmann, and at that time studies in linguistics at Leipzig University was considered a great at that time. So after he went to the University of Leipzig, he decided to take the membership of the Société de Linguistique Paris, and this was society was considered great during that time. And then he published his first articles in memoirs, and this memoirs was considered as a manifesto of that society. And in these articles, that is in the articles which is written by Saussure, he made certain radical observations, that is, he made certain observations on the vowel systems of the Indo-European languages, and this brought him reputation at the age of 20. Then afterwards he left for Berlin during 1878 to 1879 in order to study Celtic and Sanskrit. Then he was then awarded PhD by Leipzig University in 1880, and his thesis was the analysis of the genitive absolute construction in Sanskrit. And in 1880, he went to the Paris with the purpose of doing a second doctorate. And he was already well known there because of his publications and memoirs. And he was hired within months to give lectures on the historical linguistics of Gothic and Old High German at the École Pratique des Hautes Etudes. Soon he had to take up the position of the adjunct secretary of the Société de Linguistique. Saussure taught at the École Pratique des Hautes Etudes till 1889. Then he returned to Geneva on to leave for a year. This leave at Geneva was academically not fruitful, and he had to meet with some personal crisis. He returned back to Paris for the academic year 1890 to 1891, but decided to go back permanently to the University of Geneva to teach Sanskrit and the history and comparison of the Indo-European languages. In 1894, Saussure was one of the main organizers of the 10th International Congress of Orientalists in Geneva, where he gave a paper which would later be known as Saussure's Law. His other important works include his articles on Lithuanian language. Saussure married Mary Fish in 1892, and by 1895 they had three sons, Jacques, Raymond and André, of which André died of cholera at infancy. Saussure was suffering from chronic arteriosclerosis, and on February 22, 1913, he breathed his last. So now we can discuss some of his key works. And the first one is The Essays of Memoir. So the memoir, which was published in December 1878, offers a path-breaking discussion on the vowel system of the Indo-European languages. So in this, Sashaw proposed that there is just one vowel. So in the stressed syllables, there is just one vowel in the original Indo-European mother language. So in the mother language, so in the Indo-European mother language, Sashaw says that there is just one vowel in the stressed syllables. And in this mother languages, the A will be pronounced as E. The A will be pronounced as E, and he symbolized it as A and 1, A1. He symbolized it as A1. Subsequently, in some linguistic environments, A1 shifted phonetically to O, and he symbolized this variant as A2. So first, the A in the mother language of Indo-Europeans, the A will be pronounced as E, and he symbolizes this as A1. Subsequently, in some other linguistic environments, the A1 will be phonetically shifted to O, that is, the pronunciation will be changed to O, and he symbolized this variant as A2. At first, the raising and backing were not. So at first time, the speakers were not able to identify the difference between these sounds. And they immediately started to identify the difference after Sashar's findings. And Sashar called this variance as colorings. And later, this was termed as allophonic variance. And however, they came to signal nuances in meaning, such as different tenses of the same verb. Sashaw argued that the primitive Indo-European syllable could have had one or four possible nuclei, A1 or A2 on their own, or forming a diphthong with another sound, which he termed as the coefficient sonantic. So, Sashaw says that the primitive Indo-European syllable consists of four possible nuclei. And the first one is A1 or A2, or forming a diphthong with another sound. So, you know, diphthong, it is a sound. And according to Sashaw, a diphthong with another sound was considered as a nuclei, and the diphthong with another sound was termed as coefficient sonantic, because this term was given because its coeffect with the vowel on later developments of the sound system. It has to be a sonant capable of functioning as either a semi-consonant or a vowel, because one eventual development was for the A1 or A2 to disappear, leaving the sonant coefficient as the lone vowel of the syllable. Alternatively, the sonant coefficient might disappear, leaving a trace on the preceding vowel, such as lengthening or a change in quality or stress. So soon after the memoir, soon after his articles in the memoir was published, the Danish linguist Hermann Mohler proposed that these three sounds might correspond to the laryngeal consonants, which he had recently posited to Proto-Indo-European. Sashaw neither accepted nor rejected this possibility, and he would later accept Brugmann's identification, which was founded in 1886. Both Mohler and Brugmann's suggestions provided evidence for the earlier unity of the Indo-European and Hamito-Semitic language family, which Mohler was so keen to prove. And Sashaw became most famous with the book The Courses in General Linguistics, or Corsi di Linguistica Generale. This work was put together by his colleagues Charles Bailey and Albert Sicciai, mainly using the notes of students along with some manuscript notes from Sashaw from the general linguistic courses he gave in Geneva. So Shore had to accidentally take up the responsibility of giving the course in general linguistics at the University of Geneva in 1907. He, being a person interested in Sanskrit and Latin, had to struggle hard with the courses he had little interest in. However, in the course of his classes, he could develop his ideas clearly. He had to start from questioning the meaning of such basic terms like lang, language, parole, which are used more or less interchangeably in colloquial French to indicate language in general, a particular language, a text, an utterance, a word, etc. Towards the end of his third and final course, he could finally describe language as a system whose every element is attached to every other element, and where the content of an element is purely a value generated by its different of every other element. The book offers explanation of the key concepts such as lang and parole, nature of linguistic science, language as a system of science, signifier and signified, diachrony and synchrony, etc. that Sachar discussed and developed in his lectures. So that's it. I hope you understood the topic well. See you soon in the next video. Bye.